Good morning. Hope y'all are doing well this morning. It's good to see everyone. I was looking for a verse to share with everyone this morning as we begin service this morning. I'm in the book of Colossians, chapter 1, verse 16. For by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created by him and for him. And he is before all things, and by him all things consist. And he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence. For it pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell. Amen. We come here this morning in praise and worship and thankfulness. It's just awesome to see everybody here this morning. Beautiful day. It's been a beautiful weekend. And we have so many things that we can thank the Lord for this day and every day. So let's begin by going to the Lord in prayer. Jesus, we just thank you so much for your grace and your mercy and your kindness, for everything that you have created for us in this world. Lord God, we come this morning to your house to worship you, to thank you for those blessings. Lord, I thank you for each and every person that is here this morning, fellowshipping and worshiping in your name. And I pray, Lord, that this morning as we come to you, that you would bless us with your presence. Lord, fill this place with the Holy Spirit. Lord, that we would have a wonderful time worshiping in your name. Lord, I pray that you bless the music, bless the preaching. We thank you so much for Brother Poe, who is coming to bless us with the Word of God this morning. Thank you for Kay being back safely with us to play. Lord, this is where we come for peace and comfort and strength. Lord, I pray that you help us to set aside the noise of the world and the week, the stresses and temptations, and help us to focus solely on you this morning as we worship in your name. We thank you for all that you do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And as we come to the Lord in music this morning, this is our time to give our heart to the Lord, and that's what we're singing about this morning. Let's all stand together and sing, "Come, now is the time to worship."
Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come,
Amen. You may be seated as we prepare our hearts for prayer this morning. I want to remind everyone that we have our prayer request list outside on the connection table. So all of you can grab one of those on your way out and use it in your daily prayer lives. There are a lot of folks that that need prayer right now. We need to be praying for our church, of course, and the church in general. We had another wonderful time at Kids Club on Tuesday, so I want to thank everyone who is involved with our Kids Club ministry on Tuesday nights. We had a really great time. I know Braden had a good time helping out. I had a good time helping cook. Haven't heard about any of the kids getting sick, so I guess the cooking was all right. If you want to be a part of that, it's a really awesome ministry that we have going right now every Tuesday here at Park Place, and we're very thankful that we've been able to get that going. We need to be praying for our men and women in law enforcement. We had another tragic situation this past week in Raleigh, right, where an officer lost his life and several people in a neighborhood lost their lives. And there's evil in this world, right? There's evil in this world, and we need to be in constant prayer about that. But there's a lot of goodness, too, and we need to be really dwelling on that and praying about that and thanking the Lord for peace and comfort and strength. And we need to be praying for those folks in that neighborhood in Raleigh, for the people who lost loved ones this week in that tragic situation. So I'm sure you all have folks on your minds and on your hearts that you've been praying for. So let's all go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Father, we just thank you again for bringing us all together. And Lord, we are crying out to you right now, Lord, because there is so much there's evil in this world, there's chaos in this world, and Lord, we're praying for peace, we're praying for comfort, we're praying for strength. Lord God, we pray for those families that are hurting right now in Raleigh, the ones who are dealing with the loss of a loved one, the family of that officer who lost his life this week, the families that lost a loved one this week. That's an unimaginable grief. And so, Lord, I pray that you find a way to help heal those broken hearts, Lord God. And for the families that were affected in that neighborhood, Lord, I pray that you bring peace to them somehow, that they are able to overcome this and be able to go back to living their lives in peace and in comfort. So, Lord, we're praying for those folks today. And Lord, there are so many others who are dealing with loss right now. Lord, we pray that you mend all of those broken hearts. And Lord, we have folks that we know and love who may be dealing with physical ailment. This is Breast Cancer Awareness Month, so we are praying for those folks who are survivors, those who are continuing to fight. We pray for folks in our families, in our congregation, people that we love who just are not doing well right now and need an extra special touch of grace. Lord, there are also so many folks who are dealing with spiritual battles. You tell us, Lord, that you that we are not just being fought by a physical presence, but it's by powers and principalities that we can't even possibly fathom. But we know that you are fighting on our behalf, that you're our rock and you're our strength. And we thank you so much, Lord, for even when we don't know it, fighting on our behalf. And Lord, we're praying for that right now and crying out for that. Lord, there are so many folks who are dealing with these issues. And Lord, we just pray for each and every one of them. Lord, we pray for our church, Lord, that you are able to help us to continue to be a blessing in this community. Lord, there are folks here in our neighborhood who need Jesus, and I pray, Lord, that you bless us with windows of opportunity to reach out to these folks and share the gospel of Jesus Christ with each and every one of them. We thank you for what you've already done in the life of this church. We thank you for the children that are coming to visit us on Tuesdays and on Sunday mornings, and we thank you for the folks who have stepped up and are volunteering their time to help those children learn about Jesus. And Lord, the prayer is that they'll in turn share that with their families, and it'll just continue to spread. And Lord, we pray that Not only you fill our church with bodies, with folks that we can minister to, but also fill it with the Holy Spirit, Lord, and fill us with that desire to go out and have the courage to spread your word and to reach the people here in this community. We pray for the church as a whole. It's not only our church, but it's every church right now that has its own struggles and is dealing with those struggles. And so, Lord, I pray that you help the church as a whole to be able to do what we are told to, the Great Commission, Lord, that we go out and reach others for Christ. Now, Lord, as we get ready to listen to Brother Poe preach the word, I pray that you bless him with the message that you would have us to hear this morning, something that's going to step on a few toes, something that we'll be able to use in our daily lives and share with others. Lord, we thank you and praise you for all that you do. In Jesus' name, amen. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Let's all stand together and sing our hymn this morning, Blessed Assurance. Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. Greet our visitors. Greet one another with the right hand of fellowship this morning. Here we go. Perfect submission. All is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above. Filled with his goodness, lost in his love. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior. Amen. You may be seated. I'm going to sing a good old-fashioned hymn here for our special, but before I do, let me just quickly introduce Jason Poe to everyone, and I just met you this morning, so I don't have the full biography, but Brother Poe's been in the ministry for 18 years, he was telling me, has a family of four, and he is a member over at Green Street and is blessing us with a message here this morning, and we thank you so much. He's still back in college, right, studying, and so we thank you for being with us this morning and sharing a message with us. We greatly appreciate you being here with us. So with that being said, we walk by faith, not by sight. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7, we should all be striving for just a closer walk with thee. I am weak, but thou art strong. Jesus, keep me from all wrong. I'll be satisfied as long as I walk. Let me walk close to thee. Just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be. Through this world of toil and snares, if I falter, Lord, who cares? Who with me my burden shares? None but thee, dear Lord, none but thee. Just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be. When my feeble life is o'er, time for me will be no more. Guide me gently, safely o'er to thy kingdom shore, to thy shore. Just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be.
Well, good morning. As Brother Chris has already said, my name is Jason Poe, with no relation to Edgar Allan. That's always the first question anybody ever asks. It's a pleasure to be here. Brandon and the rest of the staff and the church have always kept us up to date with how things are going over here. A few weeks ago, he mentioned in the pulpit that he was preaching over here in between our two services, and with the unfortunate circumstances that your interim pastor had to resign due to some health issues, I understand that he's starting to make a little bit of a recovery, so we do continue to pray for him. But I sent him an email and said, you know, if and at this point I didn't know that he had resigned, but I said, if you ever need me to preach, I'd be happy to do that for you. And so he emailed me back within about 24 hours and said, let's meet. And he was happy to get a little bit of help. I know that he's going to be coming back. He's going to be preaching a couple of weeks at least, I think, is his plan. I am just here to fill in. You're still going to be able to see him and hear him. I do want to open up God's Word this morning. Let's start in 2 Chronicles. 2 Chronicles chapter 32. 2 Chronicles chapter 32. Now, if I happen to mess up and say 2 Corinthians at some point there in the message, I mean 2 Chronicles, so don't get confused. The two kind of slide off the tongue kind of the same way sometimes. But I do appreciate the warm welcome that I was given this morning. It was so glad to meet some of you, and really appreciate what you have here and your outreach to the community. That's so important. At Green Street, what we're going over this month is stewardship. And so I wanted to take a verse that we were going to be using in our Sunday school, and just talk about that a little bit this morning. And it also is a verse that is important to me because it's a, unfortunately, it's an infamous verse in the Old Testament for the reason of he's a person who is a good person. He was a good king, King Hezekiah, and he followed the Lord. He had Isaiah as his right-hand man and other prophets as well in his long career and life as a king. But after he was healed, he made a terrible mistake and a terrible comment that has application for any generation. But it ended up being all, of course, God's will. But this is the first time that Babylon is actually mentioned as the country that's going to defeat Judah. For a long time, the focus in this section of the Bible was on Assyria, and Assyria shows up just the chapter before in 2 Chronicles. But in 2 Chronicles 32, we see that Hezekiah became sick. In fact, it says that he became mortally ill in chapter 32, verse 24. It says in 2 Chronicles 32, 24, "In those days Hezekiah became mortally ill, and he prayed to the Lord, and the Lord spoke to him and gave him a sign. But Hezekiah gave no return for the benefit he received, because his heart was proud. Therefore wrath came upon him and on Judah and Jerusalem." Let's stop right there and let's pray together. Father, we do pray that as Christians, as believers who follow you, that we are giving you return for the benefits that we have received. Sometimes it's easy to forget the benefits that we have received from you. So the phrase we know is true, that we should count our blessings. But Lord, we thank you for the life, the ministry, the faith that we see in Hezekiah. And let this one act not be all that we remember from Hezekiah, but at the same time, let this mold us and shape us so that we do not make the same mistake. We thank you for your blessed benefits on our life and on our church. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Now, this phrase this story is actually shared three times in the Bible. And God, whenever he repeats himself, is because he wants us to know about it. So in 2 Kings, we're going to be turning there as well before long in 2 Kings chapter 20. The same story is told to us, just a little bit more information. And Isaiah chapter 39 also records this, because Isaiah is the one who shared the prophecy. And it's the first time that Babylon is mentioned as the invaders to Jerusalem, which actually, from Hezekiah's point of view, is going to happen in about 120 years. So it's not going to happen during his lifetime, but the Lord began to prophesy, or he used prophets to prophesy that Babylon is the one that is going to come down and defeat Judah, just as Assyria was the one who came down and defeated Israel. But I want to talk about our blessed benefits this morning. And the first thing that I want to talk about is the fact that our blessed benefits have been received. You know, sometimes it's hard to remember just how blessed we truly are. Doesn't matter who we are, doesn't matter where we're living or anything like that, but the blessings that we receive. Now, Hezekiah had a lot of blessings. Of course, he was a special guy. He was a man who was in the view of David. He was a man after God's heart, not as faithful as David perhaps, but at the same time, he was considered to be a good king. He was faithful. He did a lot of things for the temple. He brought back temple worship. He reinstituted the Levitical family line and the family tree into the worship. A lot of that had fallen apart. And even during the time whenever Israel was being decimated, instead of him bragging about it or wagging his head as other enemies might have been doing, what he did is he reached out to Israel, at times mortal enemies between the two of them, because they had several civil wars over the time of both countries. And he invited them to come down to worship so that they could worship together as one unified group of Jews again. So this is the first time that they have been invited to worship together since the split so many years prior to Hezekiah's lifetime. But Hezekiah was a very blessed individual. He did a lot of good. He united the people. And he stood in strong faith against some terrible enemies. The Assyrians were known as bad people. Now, what they would do is just terrible things. They would kill women and children and babies. And they would just completely decimate the cities that would not surrender to them. And then once you did surrender to them, what they would do is they would pick you up, they would move you into another area of the world that they had already conquered and bring those people over and make them live so that you don't have a homeland anymore. And this is what happened to the northern country of Israel when Assyria came into them. But Hezekiah stood up to them, and the Lord showed him his power because miraculously the Assyrians left that area and did not return. So all the things that he did, the Bible says, prospered. All these things happened and he prospered. And so he was sick and he turned his face towards the wall, the Bible says, and he asked God and pleaded for his life and asked him to live. And the Lord granted him 15 more years. And that's a popular thing in the Bible, not the word 15, but the fact that God gave Hezekiah 15 more years. And you know, he said that to Hezekiah. He didn't say it to anybody else. This is not a promise that God always gives to people. He doesn't, whenever he heals someone, he doesn't automatically give them 15 years or anything like that. But he told Hezekiah he could live for 15 more years. And in that time, he had a son, Manasseh, who was born, who ended up being an evil king, but then turned his life around. But Hezekiah was ultimately blessed in many great ways. Let's look in the scripture in 2 Chronicles 32, and let's look at verse 27 now. Now Hezekiah had immense riches and honor, and he made for himself treasuries of silver, gold, precious stones, spices, shields, and all kinds of valuable articles. Storehouses also for the produce of grain, wine, and oil, pens for all kinds of cattle, and sheepfolds for the flocks. He made cities for himself and acquired flocks and herds in abundance, for God had given him very great wealth. It was also Hezekiah who stopped the upper outlet of the waters of Gihon and directed them to the west side of the city of David. And Hezekiah prospered in all that he did. So we want to recognize in our own lives the same things that Hezekiah is recognized for. Now, we may not be convinced in our own life that everything we do prospers, but we can take a summary of our life and think about how God has blessed us, the things that he has given us, not just as individuals, but where we live and what we do, who we are, all the things that we know come from the Lord. You know, it's easy for us to say, the Lord has done so much for me, but what has the Lord done? These are things that I think are important for us to recognize First of all, so that we don't get on our high horse and think that we somehow have done it all ourselves, but also so that God gets the praise which he deserves because he's the one who's done it. If we are believers, and if since we are believers, and since we know that God controls these things, then he is the one who has done it in us or through us or for us or allowed these things to happen. So these are blessed benefits that Hezekiah received. What are the blessed benefits that you have received in your life? Now let's turn backwards in our Bibles a little bit to the other part of what we're going to look at in 2 Kings chapter 20. 2 Kings chapter 20. What the Lord wants us to do is praise him for the things that he has given us. However, we're going to find that in this one time, Hezekiah did not do that. Now, Chronicles also tells us that even in the event of the Babylonians who came to visit him, the Lord left him as a test. And unfortunately, Hezekiah failed this test to the detriment of himself, his family, and the country. But at the same time, the Lord had this planned as well. It's that shady area that we don't really know exactly how it works between God's ordained plan and man's actions. God knew it was going to happen. It was already foretold that it was going to happen, and yet he used Hezekiah to bring it about in Hezekiah's sin. Now, in 2 Kings chapter 20, a little bit more of the story is told to us. In verse 12, he begins, "At that time," now this is already talking about Hezekiah's illness. He turned to the wall. God sent Isaiah, and he said, "Tell him you're going to die from this illness." So Isaiah went and told him, "The Lord says you're going to die." Hezekiah bitterly wept. It says he turned his face away on his bed, and he wept and asked the Lord for more time and not to die yet. And the Lord granted that to him and told him, "In 3 days you're going to heal. You're going to worship in the temple, and I'll give you 15 more years, and then I will give you a sign." And so he, through Isaiah, said, "What sign do you want?" So he asked him that the shadow on the steps descend 10 steps, which means that the sun would go backwards. He said, "It's easy for it to go down the steps," because apparently that was the natural way of doing things, of how the sun went down. But he said, "I want it to go backwards 10 steps." And so the Lord gave him that sign of the shadow on the steps going backwards 10 steps. Now, that's pretty cool, isn't it? That's an absolute sign that the Lord has done this for you and that the Lord is in charge of your life, I would think. And yet, the Bible tells us in verse 12, "At that time, Baladad, I guess that's how you say it, the son of Baladan, king of Babylon, sent letters and a present to Hezekiah, for he had heard that Hezekiah had been sick." Verse 13 says, "Hezekiah listened to them and showed them all of his treasure house, the silver, the gold, the spices, the precious oil, the house of his armor, and all that was found in his treasuries. There was nothing in his house or his domain that Hezekiah did not show them. Then Isaiah the prophet came to King Hezekiah and said to him, what do these men say and where have they come from? And Hezekiah said, 'They have come from a faraway country, from Babylon.' And he said, 'What have you seen? They seen in your house?' So Hezekiah answered, 'They've seen it all that is in my house. There is nothing among my treasuries I have not shown them.' And Isaiah said to Hezekiah, 'Hear the word of the Lord. Behold, the days are coming when all that is in your house and all that your fathers have laid up in store to this day will be carried to Babylon. Nothing shall be left, says the Lord. Some of your sons who shall issue from your loins, whom you will beget, will be taken away. They will become eunuchs in the palace of the king of Babylon.' And when Hezekiah said to Isaiah, 'The word of the Lord which you have spoken is good.' For he thought, 'Is it not so that there will be peace and truth in my days?'" What a chilling final thought of Hezekiah that the Lord reveals to us in verse 19. Because basically what Hezekiah is saying in this moment of just of the human heart doing what the human heart does, which is lying to us or trying to comfort us in our own sin. But what a chilling thought that a man who is king and in charge of so much would say to himself, well, you know what? That's okay, because at least there will be peace in my lifetime. You know, I don't really care about the next generation, because at least there'll be peace until I'm dead. That's one of the worst verses in the whole Bible for someone to speak. And to think that it came from someone who was such a strong believer is so chilling. And I think that's one of the reasons why it's so infamous in Hezekiah's life. Again, it should not be something that we only remember from Hezekiah. But at the same time, it should be something that we learn lessons about. What the Lord desired and always desires from Hezekiah and from you and I is whenever someone comes and inquires or is thankful for the things that God has done for us, that instead of us bragging on ourselves, that we brag on Him, right? We brag on His Son. And that's what God is looking for. He not only gives us benefits so that we may receive them because He loves us, but also that His name be praised. And He is looking for praise on the lips of those people who follow Him and believe in Him. And these Babylonians came down hearing that He was sick, finding Him miraculously healed, and then He showed off all this stuff. That's not what God had in mind. These are unbelievers who worship different gods, who are going to hell when they die. And they got a grand tour of spices and shields and gold and silver. And as far as we know, they heard nothing about the great God Yahweh who healed Hezekiah. They didn't see the steps on which the shadow went backwards 10 steps. But instead, they saw all of the treasuries of Jerusalem. And in little over 100 years from the time that Hezekiah is alive now, they're going to come and they're going to take them all away. And that's recorded in the Bible too. What was God looking for? God wants us to praise Him. You see, that's what the Bible said in the first section that we read, that he gave God no return for the benefits that He had received. God is looking for a return on the benefits that He gives to you and me. And in that return, that is praise. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Amen? And this is what Hezekiah should have done. But for whatever reason, in this fallen state, that he had visitors. And I'm sure that there were a lot of political pressures too, because Babylon at the time was a relatively small country. Judah at the time had been almost wiped out by Assyria, but God had miraculously saved them already. And so these were two smaller countries who I'm sure Hezekiah thought, you know, I might be able, if I show them that I have a lot of money, I might be able to show them that I can pay them to support me if that time comes again. I mean, it makes sense. It seems like a logical thing to do. But it's not the way that God works. God had already saved him. God had already told him that Assyria was not going to return back to his kingdom in his lifetime. And yet it seems as if he showed them all the treasures and everything to not only show what he had accumulated, but perhaps also to try to make a deal. You know, in our lifetime, it seems like we always want to be able to be good to the people that we think can be good back to us. That's not always what God wants out of us. What God wants is for us to praise Him for the benefits that we have received, and all of those things will fall into place if we praise Him abundantly. Hezekiah said, is it not so, if there will be peace and truth in my day? There is no apparent desire or care for future generations, only for my generation. And then as Ezra was writing 2 Chronicles, he summed it up the way that we've already read, that he gave no return for the benefit. Now, God is looking for a return of the benefit, and you don't have to turn here, but in Matthew chapter 25, Jesus tells the parable of the talents. He says, heaven is like a man who's about to go on a journey who called his own slaves and entrusted his possessions to them. To one he gave 5 talents, another 2, another 1, each according to his own ability, and he went on to his journey. And immediately the one who had received the 5 talents went and traded with them and gained 5 more. The one that had 2 talents went and traded with them, he gained 2 more. The one with 1 talent buried his, and then whenever the man came back from his long journey, he came for an accounting of what he had given each person. The master said to the first one, well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful with a few things, I'll put you in charge of many. Enter into the joy of your master. The one with 2 talents came back and said, I have doubled yours too. See, 2 more talents. He said, well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful in a few things, I'll put you in charge of many. The one who had received 1 talent came and said, master, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you scatter no seed. And I was afraid, and I went away and I hid your talent in the ground. So here, you can have your talent back with nothing on top of it. The master answered, you wicked, lazy servant. You know that I reap where I do not sow and gather where I scattered no seed. Then you ought to have at least put my money in the bank, and on arrival, I would have had my money back with interest. Now, Jesus says this not because he's interested in us playing the stock market. Jesus says this because he's interested in what he has given us to get a return back from it, that he get praise back from it, that he have others enter the kingdom back from us entering the kingdom. The only thing that we're going to have in heaven that we have here are the people that we led to the Lord or that we had an impact in their lives. Those are the things and the treasures that we are going to store up in heaven and have in heaven. And if we just simply bury inside ourselves everything that God has given us, all of the blessed benefits that he has given to us, with whatever excuse that we want to give, well, I don't really know if God's going to bless it. I'm not really sure about this, or I'm not really sure what to do, how to do it, if God will bless it, when God will bless it. Then ultimately, he gets no return for the benefit that he gave to us. And Christ requires a return from you and I. One time I was thinking about this, and I was easier for me sometimes, you know, because we know that the ultimate price that was paid for your salvation and my salvation is Jesus Christ. He became sin, our sin, on the cross. And in doing that, God punished him for your sin and my sin. All Christians who will ever be saved, Jesus took our punishment on the cross. He literally became sin and a curse on a tree for you and I. And really, in our lifetime, it is so difficult for us to fathom exactly what he went through. Perhaps in heaven, we'll get a better understanding of that. But at the same time, there are other ways in which he has blessed us too and put us in positions to which we can share with others. We can help others. We can be there for others. We can lift up the poor, the unfortunate. We can be there for our friends, but also we can be the good Samaritans if we need to be. So for me, it was a little bit easier for me to put things a little bit in monetary terms because that's how we kind of view things in America anyway. And I kind of thought, well, for 18 years, if we grow up in church for 18 years, we have personal tutors who teach us the Bible for at least an hour a week if we go once a week while we're children for 18 years. Do you know how much a tutor costs these days? Let me give you a hint. They ain't cheap. And yet we get personalized tutoring for 1 hour a week for 18 years on the Bible. And then, whenever we think about the fact that we have on call a professional person who can give us advice or can give us counseling for, let's say, 50 years of our lives. For the first 50 years of our lives, we have someone on call who can do that. Now, monetarily speaking, that's quite a bit of money to have someone at our disposal. We also have air conditioning. We have a roof over our heads. Hey, listen, I grew up in the mountains, and I went to a lot of churches raising money for a children's home before I became a pastor. Don't take for granted the fact that we have indoor plumbing in our churches, because there are probably several of you who probably grew up in a church whenever you were children who had sheds out back. And in the mountains, you have to put locks on them to keep the critters from living in them. And it ain't fun going out there in the wintertime. You just learn to hold it, right? But we have indoor plumbing, of all things, in churches. We have climate control. And those things cost money too. These are all things to our benefit so that we don't have to worry about the outside circumstances, so that we can focus on the Lord. And these things all cost something. If we go anywhere else, it costs. We have a support group in Sunday school or small groups at our disposal. Do you know what it costs a lot of times to join a group or to get counseling from peers and friends in different groups? Those things cost money as well. So very roughly, I was able to kind of just lightly figure up that in about 50 years of church, don't forget also study material. In about 50 years of going to church, the Lord and the church has invested somewhere around $300,000 in us. Are we giving a return to the Lord in what we're doing for the Lord in monetary terms, just to put it in monetary terms? Are we giving that back to the Lord? Is he getting a return on the $300,000 that he likely spent on you and me? How much has he spent in the last 5 years? How much has he spent in the last 10 years that could have gone somewhere else, but instead he chose to invest it in me? He chose to invest it in you. And Christ demands a return on what he wants. You see, he wants a return for the benefits that we have received. That's what he's looking for from Hezekiah. That's why the Bible says in Chronicles in chapter 32 that Hezekiah did not give God a return on the benefits that he received. And that's what God is interested with in me and you. In those days, Hezekiah became mortally ill, and he prayed to the Lord, and the Lord spoke to him, and he gave him a sign. But Hezekiah gave no return for the benefit he received. He gave no return for the benefit he received. Instead, he said, well, at least there'll be peace and safety in my lifetime. How sad that those were the final words spoken by Hezekiah. In some ways, you might think, well, that's not really fair concerning all the things that he did. But ultimately, unfortunately, that showed his heart when God tested him. What God is looking for is for us to invest back all that he has taught us, all that he has put inside of us. The joy and the fruit of the Holy Spirit, the gift of the Holy Spirit, the salvation that comes for free, the free gift of salvation found in Jesus Christ, his one and only Son, the fellowship that we find in a body of believers such as this, and that we invest that back into the next generation. It doesn't have to be our own kids. It's the next generation of believers. And I'm so happy to hear that this is what this church is wanting to do in the Tuesdays and continuing to have the services and reaching out to Green Street. And I think you're doing a fantastic job, and I'm so happy that I see that there is a church in Thomasville that is doing just what God is expecting, that of all the benefits that you have received, that you are sharing them with others so that Christ can get a return on what he's invested in you and me. Not all churches do that. I was at a church long time ago. I was in search of a church. I was meeting with the search committee, and there was a couple of gentlemen on the committee. Well, there were more than that, but there were a couple that did most of the talking anyway. The others were mostly listening. We would, you know, ask questions just to see if we were a good fit. So one of the questions I asked them is, where do you see your church in the next 10 years? It's a question I always like to ask churches because I want to know what they think of their church. Another question I always ask is, if you were to disappear tomorrow, what would the community think? But I asked them, I said, in 10 years, where do you think you'll see the church? And one of the men said, I don't care, I'll be dead. And so for me, that meeting was over right there. So you see, there are still people who kind of have these attitudes that Hezekiah did at the end of his life. I don't care, I'm going to be dead. But before we die, as a matter of fact, if you think you'll be dead in 10 years, the Lord just might show you and make you live another 30. You may not even like it. But I'm so happy that there are Christians today that are doing the Christian version of paying it forward. And by doing that, they're investing in the future of their church. By giving Jesus the return on the benefits in which they receive, the return of the benefits of all the benefits that they received in church, of all the benefits from their family, whatever that might be, of all the benefits of living in this country, of all the benefits and the freedoms that we have to enjoy that other people do not enjoy, to make sure that we are giving Christ a return on all the benefits that he has given us for us to be able to live in this day and this time, when we know the end is so close to being here. God bless you. Let's all stand together. The first way in which we can give Jesus Christ back the benefits in which he has given us is to confess our sins before him and admit that we are sinners and that we need Jesus Christ as our Savior. That's the very beginning of giving back what he has already given to us. If you have not done that, I invite you to do that this morning. Father, we come before you. We pray and ask you in Jesus' name that you will help us to remember the folly of Hezekiah and that we not go that route. I thank you, Lord, for the hard work, the dedication, and the prayer that is going into this community from this church, and for the events that are taking place and the outreach and the love that is pouring out. I thank you, Lord, for the fellowship that I see this morning. And I ask you, Lord, that continue in your grace and your love by your Spirit. Lord, we pray for anyone here who does not know you, that they would come to know you so that they may enjoy the benefits of being saved, and also that they may be able to give back to you in some way or form what you have invested in them. Lord, we thank you for giving to us freely, and we ask you, Lord, that as we give back to you a return on your investment, that you will be pleased with what we have to offer. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
This morning, there may be folks on your hearts and your minds that you need to pray for, things that you may be going through in your life personally. This is your time to leave those requests at the altar. This is our invitation this morning. sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take Him at His word, just to rest upon His promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I've proved Him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more. Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust His cleansing blood, just in simple faith to plunge me neath the healing cleansing flood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I've proved Him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more. I'm going to sing one more verse. If you don't know Jesus as your personal Savior, I pray that today is the day that you come down to the altar and dedicate your life to Him. Maybe you are going through a difficult time in your life and you need an extra special touch of grace right now. Again, this is your time to come to the altar and bring it to Him. Pray for our church. Pray for our church family. Let's sing the last verse of the song.
I'm so glad I learned to trust Him, precious Jesus, Savior, friend. And I know that He is with me, will be with me to the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I've proved Him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more.
As we have folks at the altar, Kay's going to continue to play for us as I pray. Lord, we just thank You so much for this glorious service that You've blessed us with. Lord, there are folks here at the altar, Lord, that need an extra special touch of grace right now. Lord, I pray that You bless them tremendously, Lord God, that You be with them, whatever their needs may be. Lord, I pray that You grant it to them, Lord, that You work on their behalf in their lives. thank you all for being with us this morning. It was a good time to be in the house of the Lord. Richard, are there any announcements or anything that need to be made?
Just a reminder to our Sunday school teachers for the kids and their assistants, we'll meet briefly after the service.
Okay. So there'll be a brief Sunday school meeting for those who teach with the
children after Sunday school or after church. Don't forget about Kids Club on Tuesday. All right, and then we will be dismissed in a way. Rita, yes.
Oh, that's right. Yes, the football.
So on Friday afternoon, our church is going to be feeding the Thomasville High School football team. We're going to meet here. What time do we need to be here? Okay. Awesome. The more the merrier. Yep. Absolutely. Between 12 and 12:30, be here to help prepping food and prepping the fellowship hall for our guests. I know that they'll appreciate it. From what I understand, before the football season started, I think Green Street sponsored the team. There were quite a few players on the team who couldn't afford cleats, and so Green Street sponsored the team and helped get cleats for them so that they could even play football this year. So I know that they will appreciate our efforts feeding them before their game on Friday. And they're playing East, so big in-town rivalry, right? So so be here for that. All right, with that being said, if there are no other announcements, we will be dismissed in a word of prayer. Brother Bill Nix, will you dismiss us in a word of prayer, please?
Dear Heavenly Father, we